3 years ago, this month, the coronavirus changed the world. In short order, we were plunged into a sea roiling with fear, isolation, illness, and death. During that upheaval, we lost something. We all lost something. Loved ones, jobs, companionship, a sense of normalcy. For most of us, our navigational skills were pushed to the limits. We were changed by our experiences, sometimes in profound ways. Here's the story of my greatest pandemic loss. My mother died on March 31st of 2020, just a couple bewildering weeks after the shelter-in-place order came down. Now, Mom's health had been failing all along. She didn't die of COVID. She had been in hospice care, and we knew that her death was approaching. What the pandemic took from my family and me was the ability to mourn her loss together, to mark her passing. And for years, Mom had told us that what she wanted when she died was for her children and her grandchildren, her great-grands, some 40 of us in all, to gather for a big meal at the Union Hotel in Occidental. That's my family's place. That's where we've gone to celebrate things for generations. And of course, this wasn't possible. We waited until last August, actually, to get together and to inter her ashes. And we still haven't had that big meal at the Union Hotel. When we did get together, I realized how much of I'd missed out on watching my great nieces and nephews, my great nibblings, growing up. I'd missed so much of their lives. And that was really sad. It's really sad to think about. And I know that all of you suffered losses of all kinds of losses during this last 3 years. And I want to take a moment to reflect on those. So what I would like to do is to pass out some pieces of paper to all of you and to invite you to write on your paper a loss, something that you've lost from this time, a source of grief or sadness. And those of you who are on Zoom may want to write down something as well. Write it on a paper or your computer, or enter it into the chat if you'd like to share it. So we'll have a moment of silence. I think Brian's going to play for us, and we'll pass out the papers and give you a moment to write, and then we'll collect them again. I'm going to grab some pens for you. Thank you. as you wrap up your thoughts, what we're going to do is collect the papers and redistribute them so that they can be read aloud. You won't read your own, they'll be read anonymously. If you don't want yours read aloud, please mark it on the top or just don't turn it back in. All right? Pass them around and please take one. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, you have not gotten yours to read. If so, you might want to exchange it. And I'm just going to pass the mic around and give you a chance, each of you, to read one aloud. So let us hear the sorrows that we're holding and take them into our collective body here and understand what it is that we've all gone through. All right. During the COVID, I lost dancing, my favorite activity. To dance, I can go out in space. I try to meditate, listen to music, and dance in space.
I miss being with friends and family. Living alone is so hard.
Missed celebrating my granddaughter turning 21 by taking her on trip to New York. Also watching my other granddaughter graduation from high school.
The loss of trust in our scientific institutions as they tried to guide us through the pandemic, all the while learning about COVID themselves. The skepticism.
The inability to visit my former husband at the veterans home. My three great-grandchildren barely know me since their parents are anti-vaxxers.
A wedding with friends.
Bob didn't get a memorial service. My oldest and dearest friend died from COVID.
I lost my younger sister, Jane, as well as the opportunity to celebrate her life together.
This is a list. Geraine Park, my stepmother, Mary Nell, family celebrations and gatherings, travel, honoring deaths with in-person memorials.
My son's trust and my trust in him.
I lost the love of my life, my Ralph.
John, my husband, Sissy, my sister-in-law.
And I just want to say, explain what we're doing, that we've written sorrows that have arisen during the COVID pandemic, and we're reading those aloud now, but anonymously.
I lost some of my sense of security and the community of family and neighbors.
Loss, getting together with old friends and going out to enjoy dancing and other outdoor activities.
Do you have one, Richard? One online.
She missed her grandchildren that live out of state.
Let us hold all of these. I can switch back. Let us hold all of these sorrows, all of these griefs in our heart. And let us sing Comfort Me. It's hymn 1002, but you probably don't need your hymnals for this, and I will call out what the verses will be.
Thank you.
And now I invite you to take a moment to look around you. Look at who is here with you. And I'm looking at you, folks on Zoom. You are here. You have made it through 3 years of pandemic. You have made it through 3 years of uncertainty, marked by long periods of doldrums while we were in isolation, and stormy seas and riptides threatening to take us under. One way or another, you have found ways to get through that time, to get through the pandemic. And although struggles during the pandemic may have made you tired, diminished, and although at times you may have felt anger, sorrow, distress, or frustration, I'm willing to bet that every one of you here has found strengths and comforts and gifts within you and around you that got you through. I'll bet you found moments of joy that refreshed your soul. So I want to celebrate that for a moment. The resilience that is here in this room. The resilience that is in our lives. And I wonder what you did, what those things were that helped you get through. I know in those early days of pandemic, if I didn't have beautiful places to walk, if I wasn't able to get out and take walks, I don't know what I would have done. Fortunately, I was working down in the Monterey Peninsula, and although I was living by myself and I didn't see a lot of people, I could go walking every day by the sea or in the mountains, in the forest. And that was a huge gift because it gave me time to reflect on how interconnected we were and feel like I was a part of that interdependent web, even though I was by myself for so long. And I will also say that the challenge of preparing and leading worship and offering pastoral care and connecting with people I had never met before in this congregation that I served, the challenge of that made me a better minister, helped me to relate to people in a different way, and taught me strengths that I didn't know I had. So I found depth and creative resources in that process and found ways of connecting with people, just walking on the trail, right, with the mask on, smiling with my eyes. Can you all do that now? You remember, right? We made that eye contact and made those connections. So I would very much like to invite Annette and then Margaret up to tell a pandemic story and share that with us.
Me again. It was February of 2020. Jim and I had just returned from La Paz, the capital of Baja California del Sur. Our older dog, Sadie, had died about a year before, and we decided we would get a second dog again after returning from La Paz when we were ready to adopt again. That took about a year. But when we got home, the government told us to shelter in place. As people were home more, we were not the only folks around who wanted to adopt a young dog. I searched far and wide. It was a frustrating experience. Our older dog, Milo, was definitely lonely. I kept a scribbled chart on a legal pad where each line was about a different potential new dog. Each one required a lengthy and detailed application procedure. After a while, I actually gave up looking. Every dog I pursued was quickly adopted before I could even make an application. I spent months in distress with nothing much to do. In March of 2021, I sent an application out to Modesto. which Susan Okun said was the heart of the Central Valley. Susan thought I'd have a better chance there. The dog's picture hadn't even gotten published on Petfinder yet, but we won the number 3 pick of the litter of 5, whom we adopted and named Sophie. Sophie has been a gift and a treasure to us, and a wonderful playmate to Milo. She is timid but super affectionate. It was one good thing, besides Zoom, that came to us during the COVID pandemic. Thank you.
During the spring of 2020, my late husband Bob and I huddled in our house without having any other human contact. I could FaceTime my daughter Marlo and grandson TiVo, but I didn't spend any face-to-face time with them. After a couple of months of this isolated lifestyle, I longed to see my extended family. I was able to attend classes and meetings on Zoom, though. Maggie Ingalls, Iris Craig, Susan Okun, and Barbara Gaya often discussed their gardens during our Zoom check-ins. It occurred to me that it would be safer for me to grow my own vegetables than to eat the food I had Raley's deliver. God knows who had touched that food. Since Bob's Alzheimer's was getting worse, gardening would be a good at-home activity I could do. The problem was that I had never before been in charge of gardening. That had always been Bob's job. I called Susan Okun to discuss the idea of starting my own garden. No answer. So I left a message and dialed Master Gardener Barbara Gaya. Barbara was delighted and, as luck would have it, was going to what she called the very best nursery in the area. She volunteered to pick up some plants for me so I didn't even need to leave the house. "What do you want me to get?" she asked. I answered, just some salad stuff and squash. That's easy to grow, isn't it? How much do you want to pay? Use your own judgment. Barbara brought $95 worth of vegetables and soil for me and delivered them right to my lower yard next to the garage. She emailed me all day with just one more thing to tell me about gardening. She was so excited, and Bob was even remembering the days when he used to garden. He tried to give me the iffy advice of someone with Alzheimer's, but of course, he couldn't do any of the work. And me? I was overwhelmed with so many plants, so much enthusiasm, and all the planting rules I heard coming at me. In the meantime, I complained to Susan about having too many things to plant and asked her to come over and take some. I said, "We can easily keep our distance because the plants are just inside the gate that you can open for yourself." She agreed to come over to advise me, but didn't want to take anything. I told Bob we were going to have company, and he headed for the back deck, not for the lower area. He said we should work there. But what does he know? Ever since he got sick, I had to make all the decisions. I dressed him and helped him down the double-railed inside stairs, through the garage, out the side door, and into his special chair with arms. Susan and Barbara both arrived at the same time. All four of us wore masks and gloves, ready to protect each other. To me, it felt like a party because this had been the first time for me to have company since COVID-19. My two friends agreed they should plan first, work later. They wanted to go up to the main yard and create a planting design, not to do anything in the lower yard where I had set things up. Bob leaned over and whispered, "Told you so." Barbara darted up the stairs ahead of us. She had all the pots placed strategically around the deck and yard. I got Bob situated on the deck and drew a chair up next to him. Susan joined Barbara in the yard, and the two of them began planting the garden without me. Barbara wanted the plants to be in different places, so wherever I looked, I would see beautiful plants. Susan wanted them all in one place so they would be easy to water with the hose. Barbara said a watering can would be better than a hose. She spoke about me in the third person. She can put the tomatoes, peppers, and squash in this spot that has been walled off with stones, and the winter vegetables in the deck with filtered shade. At this point, Bob raised his voice to join in. I used to grow vegetables right in the ground. We have a sprinkling system, and there's an electric tiller in the shed. Susan's voice was soothing. That would be for someone much stronger than Margaret, Bob. The clay in Vallejo is terrible, you know. I knew the ultimate decision would be mine, so I listened quietly to each argument until Susan had to leave and Bob went inside to nap. Barbara showed me how to put in some vegetables on the deck. We planted radishes, lettuce, wild magic purple basil, chard, and New Zealand perpetual spinach. Before I went inside to lie down next to Bob, I left a message on my daughter's answering machine. Hi, Marlo, this is Mom. For Mother's Day, I'd like to invite you and TiVo to have lunch on my deck. I've already had friends come over to visit me outside. We can sit far apart and tell COVID jokes to each other. I love you.
I love those. So I know it's noon right now, so we'll shorten what we're going to do next, but I do want to pass out paper for you, and I'd like you to be able to write down something that worked for you, something that was a joy, something that you did to take care of yourself during the pandemic, something that kind of brought some life into your life. So let's just take a moment to do that. We won't pass them around again and read them aloud, but you can share them during the coffee hour.